Hello, welcome back to another Booze Adventures adventure.
We just got back, well, it was more of a sit-down video, really. We just got back from Krakow.
Yes, we had the most amazing holiday. It was so, so lovely. It's my favourite city. Poland is probably my favourite country I visited. It's just beautiful. Everywhere is beautiful.
It's really nice. We did a lot. We did Energylandia. We did Legendia.
We did Worrell Castle. We did the cathedral. And this video is all about our day on a bus tour doing Auschwitz and the salt mines.
It's basically, we booked it off Get Your Guide, which a lot of you probably heard of, to be fair. It's like a website we can book a lot of different. It's a bit like Red Letter Days. You book like loads of experiences. Do it in the UK as well.
Yeah, they do it pretty much everywhere, I think. They do it a lot of different destinations. I highly recommend them. They were really, really, really good. Reasonably priced for what you get. We also paid a little bit extra to have a lunchbox.
Like sandwiches and that, like bottled water, biscuit.
Apple. It was really nice.
It was
very good food. Our driver was lovely. She couldn't speak English, but she was really friendly. Our guide on the bus, Philip, he was really good, very funny.
He did speak
kept
English.
Everyone's energy up, considering you obviously visited a couple of very difficult places. It's just on that topic, obviously we will be talking about some of the tour of Auschwitz,
some of the content that you basically see, and it's not nice, so just a little warning.
Yeah, if you don't want to hear about that type of stuff, that's completely fine. I completely understand why someone wouldn't. So just, yeah, if you don't want to know, either skip ahead to the salt mines or stop watching here.
Basically, we started off with Auschwitz 1, which is the smaller of the two camps that we visited.
Yeah, although I feel like there was a lot more to see, even though it's a smaller camp.
It's more of a museum, and that in a sense that you do a tour and it's like a big walkthrough.
Yeah, basically. So we got picked up from Krakow at about 7:15 in the morning, and we got to Auschwitz probably at about 9.
Yeah.
We also had a tour guide there. I didn't get her name, but she was the best tour guide. If you can get her, this is why I wish I had her name. Because she was phenomenal. She was passionate. She was respectful. And again, she kind of kept everyone's spirits up here and there when she could tell the group needed a little bit of a lift.
She could also she was also not afraid to
she was not afraid to go into detail about anything. Some of the stories she told us was horrific. One that really stuck with me was the experimentation on women and children. I won't go into too much detail, but it was just horrific.
It's awful.
In Auschwitz 1, they kind of take you more through the different stages of what would happen in one of the camps. So the first block we went into was to do with the extermination. It shows you the poison that was used in the gas chambers and explains stuff like that. Then you went into a different block, which would show you more about the prisoners' lives. So there was their sleeping conditions, their hygiene facilities, which were basically nothing, let's be real.
It's awful. It's horrific.
It shows you all of their belongings they lost. And another thing that stuck with me is the fact that there was a room full of walking sticks and prosthetic legs that were taken away from disabled prisoners.
It's a lot to take in,
which is horrible. Obviously the shoes get you. There's moments where you cannot take photos. The guide will tell you where you can take photos and what you strictly cannot take photos of. The things you can't take photos of is completely understandable, which is the basement where a lot of torture with starvation and beating and just, exhaustion took place. And the other thing is there is a memorial of a wall with all of their hair. I think she said there was 2 tons of hair in there.
You can't. I think it's first of all respect, but I think it's also a legal thing.
Yeah, because it's actually it was part of the person. It's like, you know, it's not an item of theirs, like a like shoes or suitcases. Yeah. It was their hair. There was also a urn of ashes which you could take a photo of, but as they were ashes of actual prisoners, I did not take a photo of that because it didn't sit very well with me. But anything else I could take a photo of, the luggage, the gas canisters, I took photos of, and I will insert them in the video towards the end. After you finished up with Auschwitz 1, you go over to... Oh, wait, no, before we finish off with Auschwitz 1.
You have a little...
They take you in the gas chamber.
They do.
And the crematorium. You're not allowed to talk in there. Obviously, respectful. It's not just a... building, it's not just it's a grave.
It's a grave, yeah.
The first thing they say is there's three Auschwitz camps, and we just did 1 and 2. We didn't visit Auschwitz 3, but you know they can't stress enough that each camp is basically a mass cemetery. It's pretty much the whole town is just a cemetery, inside the concentration camps.
Yeah.
And there was a really nice quote on the wall that said, those who don't learn from the past are condemned to repeat it, or those who don't remember.
It's one of the first things you see.
And that is Auschwitz's aim, is to, obviously it's horrific to see, it's really difficult to see, it's upsetting, but it's to kind of keep it alive in people's minds and say, look, this didn't happen that long ago. Look how horrible it was. Let's stop it from happening again.
And I think everyone should visit it at least once in their life for that reason.
Just to see and get an understanding. You definitely feel a lot more grateful for your life and your way of living and stuff. Even though we're going through a cost of living crisis, it's nothing compared to what they went through. Mm. And like she said, the small things you just take for granted, but after visiting Auschwitz, I definitely see things in a different light now.
Yeah.
So, yeah, then you visit Auschwitz 2, which is Birkenau. This is more outdoors. It was very hot. Ewan was struggling.
It was very hot. If it's a hot day, take something like a fan.
Or an umbrella.
Just
to shade yourself as much as possible. This is probably the most famous Auschwitz. Like, if you typed in Auschwitz,
you see the photo with the train tracks.
That is Birkenau.
The bit with the train tracks, yeah.
So obviously you start off, she takes you along the platform, shows you where the selection process place. You see the wagon they were brought in, and another fact that stuck with me there was when she said that 200 people were crammed into this tiny wagon, and because a lot of them, you know, they went without toilets, they went without water, they went without food. A lot of them actually died, but because so many people were crammed in there, the train would arrive and the dead bodies would be standing because they wouldn't fall to the floor. There was no room. And that really stuck with me.
It's terrible.
I can't imagine what that must be like. Women had their kids in there. Like she was saying, how could you tell your kid that you're, you know, you might not make it out of this journey. Like, it's so horrible. It's really terrible. Difficult. What else do you see at Birkenau? You see the monument at the back, which she explained their interpretation of it. Is the monument kind of shows the different ways people died. So there's a section that kind of commemorates the death wall, which you see in Auschwitz 1 as well. A bit for hanging, you see a lot of that in Auschwitz 1. Obviously, the gas chambers you see, I think that's mainly...
Yeah, there's quite a few. Isn't there? Yeah.
And then the big thing at Birkenau is, obviously, that when the Germans realised they were being caught, they destroyed a lot of it.
Yeah, a lot of it is, like, in ruins.
So you see a lot of, like, bricks where there would have been barracks where the people would have been living. Then you see the huge destroyed crematorium, which the Germans themselves blew up.
Yeah.
That hits very hard. She was saying, you know, it's going to be left untouched. Very soon it may crumble to the ground. You know, the earth may give way and it may just all sink away. But she said that's going to be left untouched, as previously mentioned, because it is a mass grave. a lot of people died in there.
It's terrible.
The barracks that did survive, you can go in, you see their living conditions. There's a replica of the bunks they would have stayed in. However, she said the bottom layer of the bunk isn't as much of a replica as it should be, as the bottom was actually just you were sleeping in mud. So the top two are very similar to what it would have been like.
Mm.
But the bottom one, there was no wood. You were just lying in the mud, basically.
It's horrible.
Again, they show you the toilets where they had to go only twice a day on command, early in the morning or late at night. They had about 30 seconds and then a German would blow a whistle and they'd have to move out because more people were coming in. Obviously, people cannot go to the toilet on command like that. So they caught a lot of diseases through, you know, their pajamas didn't get washed or changed. So there was a lot of nasty diseases and stuff going around. So she explained that. And again, this is where she said, you know, when you sit on the toilet at home, you don't really think about it. But now just think about it and think how lucky you are.
It's awful. Absolutely horrific.
They had no running water. They had no soap, no nothing. And no toilet paper. Like, it's so humiliating for them. It's all your human rights taken away for a very stupid and sadistic reason. Auschwitz finishes up at Birkenau. Birkenau is a lot quicker than Auschwitz 1. You get through it a lot quicker.
There is a lot of walking, though.
And she does say if you want to see more of Birkenau, you can do an extended tour and they take you a little bit further out to see the other crematoriums. Which we didn't do, as our tour also then went on to the salt mines.
Salt mine is a lot more positive. It's fun.
It's very pretty. That was about an hour and a half from Auschwitz. We ate our packed lunch on the bus. You also had a snooze. And then when we arrived, we had like a half an hour break. So we just went and sat in the shop. I got myself the guidebook for the salt mines, which is really interesting. I'll have Vyshka a read through that. Mine.
Very good. It's about Auschwitz is a lot further out from Krakow.
Yeah.
It's off to the west. It's actually very close to Energylandia, which is quite interesting.
Yeah, if you were staying near Energylandia, it's a lot closer. Not far.
Vyshka salt mines a lot closer to Krakow. It's about half an hour out.
Yeah, it didn't take us long to get back.
No.
And then the salt mines, again, we had a really, really good tour guide. I cannot like recommend both tour guides enough. The one in the salt mines was called Maria and she was really, really good.
Very knowledgeable.
So they take you down loads of stairs. Thankfully, you do not have to walk back up the stairs. You can get a lift back up.
I think you do, and I think everyone does.
Yeah, so you all go down in the stairs, and then everyone gets a lift back to the surface. You go about 135 metres deep on the tourist route,
which is pretty much like 400 feet. It's crazy.
And yeah, it's just the most stunning place. One of my favourite is the chapel. I think it was like St. Nicholas's chapel.
There's three chapels, basically, because a lot of the miners were
very religious.
Very religious. So they would do their worship down in the mines.
Yes.
And the main chapel that Lou is on about is absolutely gorgeous.
It's incredible. I think she said it was like the world's largest underground church because people do actually still get married there.
You can get married there.
And it's just everything is made out of rock salt. It is so, so pretty. Another highlight down in the salt mines would be the most romantic spot, which is a lake in the middle of the salt mines. She said a lot of people get proposed to there and it is just really, really pretty. And she also said you can dive or jump into the water as it's very similar to the Dead Sea. So any human who was to go in that water would just float.
Yeah, it's very, very salty.
And it's very cold down there, which was nice on a hot day. It's a consistent temperature of about 14 to 17 degrees.
They have a ventilation system basically to preserve all the salt sculptures that they have.
So if you go through doors, you have to wait for the door behind you to close before you can open the next one. I think that's pretty much it. Again, I'll put loads of pictures from the salt mine after this. another quick mention with us, which they, our tour guide also mentioned, they're very picky, as they should be, about what is published book-wise about the place. And she recommended many, many books to people. But if you're someone like me who likes reading, she recommended Childhood Behind Barbed Wire, which is written by someone who stayed at Auschwitz. It's been translated to English from Polish, so I got myself a copy.
If it's on Amazon, we'll get you an Amazon link in the description.
Yeah, if not, I will link it to the Auschwitz website, as she also said. Just email or contact the museum. They may not get back to you like the next day, but they will get back to you if you have any questions about anything you want to read, if you're interested about any particular thing you heard on the tour, or just in about our search in general. So yeah, I think we'll leave it at that. We'll put some pictures up from our switch and the salt mines, and we will see you guys in the next video, which is going to be from Poulton's. Back to our theme park again,
of course, has to be done.
So I think that's it. I think we'll leave that on a calm and considerate note, as obviously we do want to pay our respects to those who lost their lives at Auschwitz. Exactly. And also those who lost their lives down the mines, as our tour guide there said a lot of miners did pass away there because it's dangerous. It's
dangerous workplace, and you can imagine, like, in the back, you know, before, like, a lot of the, you know, safety,
yeah,
was put in, because you can imagine a lot of the structures they were using in the mines as well were
quite dodgy.
Quite bad. There was also animals in the mines. There was horses that were taken, yeah, down there, which is not safe for the horses.
So yeah, I think we'll leave that at that. So we'll see you in the next video. And again, if there's any pictures from us which you don't want to see, just skip past them, as some of them may be upsetting.
Mm-hmm.
Bye, guys. Thank you.